All right, good evening, everybody, and welcome to tonight's select board meeting. You'll notice some strange devices sitting in front of all the members of the board here tonight. We actually have gone digital with our agenda and with our documents. We've talked many times about the board docs, boarddocs.com, and we actually have the agenda and tonight's meeting all online. So as you watch us, there's not much paper today, it's all digital. So just if you're wondering what's going on, that's kind of what's going on. So we'll get tonight's meeting started. Is there anybody here that has just public comment they want? Nope. All right, first thing on the agenda, we have the consent calendar. And on the consent calendar, we have the minutes from January 20th, warrants AP 1631, PR 1631, a payment rec for Schultz, number 17, Russellbrook Culvert installation of some riprap, dispatch resignation, and a one-day liquor license request. Is everybody okay with the consent agenda?
Make a motion to accept the consent agenda.
Second.
All right, all those in favor?
Any discussion?
And I would like to.
Is motion second, any discussion?
Not for the consent agenda, if you want to take something off.
No, I wanted to.
Do you understand the riprap? Does everybody understand the riprap? That's all I'm just asking. I do, I don't know if anybody. I was down there. I don't know if everybody else does.
I haven't seen it, but yeah.
Okay.
But I would also like to, you want to just do the thing and then I can do my thing?
Sure. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
We should take this minute to thank Jimmy Bai for all of his years of service here. I wish I had a number, but I think he's been with us forever and has been an essential part of the dispatch team for a long time. So thank you, Jimmy, for all your help and work that you've done for the town of Hadley.
So we have an appointment in another 12 minutes. So let's take on the fire chief's employment agreement.
Where is he?
Do we want to wait for the fire chief
or not?
So you all negotiated a contract with the fire chief.
I think he's busy.
Right now, yeah.
Okay.
So you negotiated a contract with the fire chief. We've come to an agreement. We've written it up in final form, and it's just one edit from the version that's on your documents, which was in the area of compensation. We had put down compensation would be in the second and third year would be a COLA plus a step, and going over the notes in consultation with the chief, we're taking out the step from the form that's going to be executed. So it's a COLA in the second and third year. That's the only change.
So there's no step, and Mike was in agreement that.
Yes, it was an agreement, and our record showed that was the case.
So does he get to choose which COLA he gets, or?
No, you all set it.
Is it going to be the COLA we give the non-union?
Yes.
Right, slipper. Sets it.
All right.
Make a motion to accept the fire chief's agreement of employment and rehire Mike for another three-year term contract from 2016 to 2019.
Second.
Any more discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Congratulations, Mike, wherever you are.
Yeah.
I think he's on 47
you lucky
right now.
Devil.
On 47.
He's somewhere
working.
In town. Yeah.
Working chief.
Okay, so annual report dedication. It's that time of year again.
Mm-hmm. Are we looking for recommendations?
Well, we've had two recommendations from the town clerk, Helen Bai and Irene Benben.
But we also have two awards, actually, the dedication of the book and the Fred Oakley Award.
And do we get a chance to weigh in on these at all?
We do.
Okay. I'd like to put in the name of Howard Koski for consideration.
And I wanted to put in the name of Dan Dudkevich for consideration also.
Okay.
He was on the Long Range Planning Committee, the Conservation Commission, and the Board of Selectmen.
CPA?
CPA.
Ad hoc CPA?
So how, if we did this, how would we want to line them up? There are two awards.
Nobody's dead yet, so I guess we have to do them while they're living, which is always a good thing. I'm always happier to do that than in memoriam, right?
When do we need that answer?
February 17th is the deadline for the annual reports. So we can take a little bit of time right now.
Next week, right.
If you're next week, we can present a lineup and some suggestions that might help you.
Would it be possible, maybe Jessica or somebody, for the individuals she had recommended two, and then the two that just came up tonight, to just give a quick summary of the number of years and all of that? I mean, I'd find that really helpful.
Yep. Okay.
It's four great suggestions.
Definitely. And if we could think of a creative way to honor them all, I think that would be a great thing, too.
We've done that in the past. We'll come up with something.
Let's
You'll
do
like
something
it.
Creative.
You'll like it.
Okay. I always like it.
All right. So we'll talk to you about next meeting.
Mm-hmm.
All right, DPW collective bargaining agreement.
We have an agreement with DPW. We've met in the executive session to talk about our take on it. We're in agreement with what we presented to them for the memorandum of agreement, and they've voted to ratify it. So now I recommend that we sign it and open the meeting.
Takes all the fun out of it, doesn't it, Marla?
It helps you out.
Good answer.
Motion to accept the DPW agreement.
Second.
Any more discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Do we need to sign anything, or does Guilford need to sign anything?
We have
I have it. We'll get
It'll
it
come.
After.
Okay.
All right. So we'll just keep moving down the agenda here. So new business, a report from the MMA meeting. Who wants to go first?
Be happy to, if that helps.
Jump right in there, moving right along.
So three of us went to the MMA annual meeting and trade show in Boston this past January. And I found it was a helpful experience. I was there for 2.5 days. The program started out with opening speaker, Mr. Guy Raz, who people probably recognize from NPR. He does the TED radio show. He talked about his life as a journalist, but he also talked, gave us an inspirational speech about the power of telling a story and how we, in our work as municipal officials, have a story to tell each and every day, and how do we communicate that to the public is important. Governor Charlie Baker came in right after and gave a preview of his budget numbers, as well as he talked about his initiative in reforming many antiquated municipal laws having to do with finances, and he called for support as this budget proposal goes through the legislative process, as well as the reform package going through the legislative process. There are many, many dozens of proposed changes, and some of them are extremely esoteric. I won't summarize them here, but my overall take from reading the proposed legislation is that it's going to be extremely beneficial to just streamlining how municipalities conduct their business. I attended the two sessions. One was the developments in municipal finances, which updated us both on the reform packages as well as some of the different ways that the Department of Revenue is going about doing their work and being partners, good partners, with municipalities. And I also took the one for modern municipal policing, which I took away from you. I wandered in there thinking it was another another seminar, and didn't realize that I bumped you. So, but that was very good, and I've had a productive conversation with our chief of police about what I learned there. The closing session was with Mr. John Harris, also of NPR. He talked about the prospects for entertaining viewing for the primaries. He told us if we were a Democrat, why we should be worried, and if we're Republican, why we should also be worried. And then finally, we got an award from our Massachusetts Interlocal Insurance Agency, gave Hadley an award for its excellence in preventing loss and controlling loss having to do with accidents, workmen's compensation, property insurance. And so we got a recognition in a statewide forum for that. So that's my report.
Anybody else?
Ladies first, or I'd be happy to go.
Go if you want.
Okay.
I'll fill in whatever.
I actually went to two of the seminars as well. One was on municipal land use and zoning update, and specifically I was there trying to understand a little more about the Dover Amendment and try to ask a little questions as to whether or not there had been any chance where everybody had had discussions or had success in the past regarding having that overturned. It was two of the folks from the panel were our neighbors to the east were on the panel, and they were lawyers for there. One was the municipal lawyer, and one was another person who was a lawyer out of there. So I kind of got I ran into a fence regarding getting any of the answers or getting any help with any of the answers there. However, we did receive the credit for the $450 to go against our Maya contract. The second one I went to was work safety regulations and municipal workers. As the liaison to the DPW, I tried to get down there to try to understand, you know, from our point of view, what we need to understand and look at and see, and if we're doing the right things. It turns out that Hadley has been reviewed recently, very recently. They said we had a good review, and any of the changes that needed to be done were changed in a very quick and effective manner, and that they thought it was a really, really good job. There are 16 agents across the entire Massachusetts that review all 351 towns. So it was a little ironic that we had, you know, within the last 4 months been reviewed by them. So they were well aware of it and stuff like that. One thing that I became aware of that I thought was just absolutely crazy, and I couldn't understand it. If they come on to the job site for whatever reason, if there's an employee that's unhappy and says, you know, you ought to get over to Hadley and check what's going out or whatever's going on, when they show up at the job site, there's notification to the municipality, or they are not obligated to notify the municipality if somebody that's in a piece of equipment is running the piece of equipment and shouldn't be in there. They get a citation from that person, they turn around and they leave. And I said, well, wait a minute, don't you think we as the employer ought to get some type of update regarding that, and so that we can correct that, either get them to classes or at least in some way are notified so it doesn't happen, you know, in 2 weeks again? And they're like, well, you need to look at us as though we were the state police. When we pull you over, I'm not calling your mommy. And that's the way it was explained to me. And I'm like, well, maybe we can look at getting that fixed. And apparently that question comes up a lot, because he was particularly annoyed with me after that. So I'm glad we've recently had our review done.
So if he comes hanging around this area now, it's your fault.
Yeah, it probably may be. And the third thing I wanted to make mention of is that when at the Selectmen's Association meeting, case in point, they're talking about new buildings in towns and the time frame and what you need to do in order to get buildings built. And they said, you know, stop it right there. It takes 5 to 10 years from the idea coming to anywhere to when you can expect there to be a shovel in the ground. And it takes that long. If you think it takes forever, it does. You have to notify everybody. You got to get everybody's input. You got to look at the financing from the 11 different ways that you can finance this, and you got to get some buy-in from the rest of the taxpayers as to what the projects are and to whether it's as important to them as it is to the people making the proposal before you. So it was a very timely thing, and Ms. Keegan was there with me, and we kind of were enlightened to a lot of the factors that were going on. It's a lot of building that's going on. The owner's property owners. Management, operator management person seems to be the most integral part of making sure that gets done and done right. And there was a lot of success stories, and there was a lot of non-success stories up there. There was also something that said that I had no idea, and it's actually contrary to what we've always been told, that you always have to accept the lowest bid on a DCAM certified bidder on a construction project, and you don't. If there's good reason for you not to, whether there's been projects that you know of that have been gone awry that these people have been involved with, and you're afraid of running into the same thing with your town, you know, it's not somebody whispering in your ear. It's probably more likely, you know, three towns over, this person was involved with the project, and you know that there's a lot of squawking going on about the project. Well, if you go out to bid and all of a sudden the lowest person bidding is the same person that's having all the rest of these problems, he said, you're going to need a lawyer, you're going to get sued, but you're going to win. So you have to sometimes bite the bullets on those projects, and you don't always have to accept the lowest bid.
So. Okay, and then just very quickly from my end, I think Jerry summarized the Selectmen's Association meeting well, and the two sessions I attended, one was on town liability, takeaway there is you can get sued for just about anything. I think we already knew that, but a lot of focus on employment law issues, and then an update on the open meeting law. But yeah, one thing I would add is that it's always good to go and learn new things and make sure that, you know, we hear things that maybe we need to do a better job at. But part of my takeaway from attending these sessions is we're doing an awful lot of things really well. Case in point, the Selectmen's Associations in smaller towns, when you're dealing with buildings, you don't have the luxury of having a master planner on staff or somebody who can really spearhead it, form a municipal building committee. You know, I was like, oh, we did that. You know, so a lot of the things that they were suggesting we have implemented, and as well as on the insurance side, I think. There are a couple of things I wanted to just have you look over, but, mm-hmm. you know, from my understanding of what we're doing here, I think we're in good shape. So it's good.
Good.
Well, last point we have is that, and I just remembered it too, is that, you know, we're obviously concerned regarding the fact that a lot of the water that we're pumping isn't being running through meters in town, and that there's, I got a chance to speak to the UMass facilities water contact person, and he said that this goes on everywhere, and he's got a guru for it, is what he explained to me about this, and he's had really good luck with it, and he said about everybody in Western Massachusetts going there and try to find water, and it ended up that he went back to someone who manufactures the equipment to actually find somebody who they thought they would recommend, and it's just a process we're going to need to go through, and should be helpful to Mr. Klimoski, mm-hmm. hopefully Mr. Warner.
Okay. Anything else? All right, so on to our 7:15 appointment. We're just a little late, but would you like to introduce?
I would. Mr. Marlowe. Warner is here from the DPW Search Committee recommendation to bring it before the Select Board. We know that the rest of the Select Board members had many questions that they wanted to ask Mr. Warner, and without further ado, Mr. Warner.
All right. So, welcome.
Welcome.
So I'll start off the first question. So why do you want to come work for us?
Well, when the process started approximately about a year ago, I saw the ad in the MMA website. Before I had applied for the job, I did quite a bit of homework, quite a bit of surfing through your website. And as I read through things, you know, the stormwater stuff you have that you're getting ahead of and stuff like that, looking at all the buildings and looking forward to possibly, you know, upgrading, rebuilding, whatever it may be for the highway building, it attracted me to apply here. I think this community is ahead of some of the issues that other communities have with their infrastructure. So that was a highlight of wanting to apply. I also think my years of experience as far as leadership experience in each of the divisions, actually having hands-on, I felt that I could be a good fit down here for your DPW.
All right.
Joyce,
did you want to ask?
If you were able to peruse the town of Hadley and see what it is there anything that you feel you need to know more of, or?
Yeah, where all the roads are. So with that being said, if I was offered the position, the first month or two obviously would be getting used to the community, introducing myself to all the department heads, getting used to the Select Board, the town administrator, the fire chief, police chief, and the other committees. And going along with that, it would be I would just be taking a backed off approach. I would like to take a look at the three divisions, see how they work, see how they operate. I certainly would not make any changes right out of the gate unless it was safety related. But I'd like to see the award and whatnot. So. First and foremost, I think it would be important for me to look at the leadership you have here. Mr. Klimoski, I've read a lot about. He would be a great deal of knowledge to understand the infrastructure, where things are. I'd have to look at the record keeping, see where we're at with projects as far as capital projects, what the priorities are at this point.
We actually had the luxury of having your resume in front of us Mr. Warner, so if you could just kind of reiterate for the rest of the people that are watching at home a little bit about your work experience, where you're coming from, and your qualifications for the job, I think it would be helpful to the rest of the people that are viewing us tonight.
Okay. I graduated from high school in 1984. I went directly into the United States Air Force. I worked my way up through the ranks in the Air Force and became a sergeant and actually led a crew. I was a munitions crew chief on the F-15 aircraft. When I got out of the military, I spent a year at the in the National Guard down at Otis Air Force Base. I went with the F-15 aircraft that I was working on to train the National Guard. I spent a year there, came back home to Greenfield. Worked in a shop environment in Greenfield Tappan Die for about 7-8 months and realized the inside environment just isn't for me. While I was working at the Tappan Die 11 to 7, I was working part-time for a local excavating unit during the day. And I got off at 7 in the morning. I was laboring for them. So it seemed like the thing I wanted to do. So I got hired by the private excavating company. I worked there 6 years. Worked my way from the laborer up through the equipment operator to running a crew on house sites and running jobs. Then the municipal job in Shelburne presented itself. Basically, it was about having food on the table year-round. I wasn't laid off if I joined a municipality. So I went to work for the town of Shelburne. I was there for 3 years. Again, equipment operator, maintenance, repairs. And then Greenfield presented itself with a wonderful job of a rubbish truck operator. So not only that, it was closer to home. So I went to Greenfield in September of 1999, started out on a trash truck. From there, I bid down to the mechanic shop as the maintenance mechanic. I worked my way up to master mechanic through testing and experience. I bid into the drainage department, worked there for a while, then I bid back into the mechanic shop as the master mechanic. At that point, a position as a supervisor opened up, an assistant field superintendent's position, and I applied for it. I was selected. I became management in 2005. From that point, I actually supervised highway traffic, solid waste, and all-road treatment operations. And also filled in for the water sewer superintendent when he was on vacation. All this while, I was obtaining my distribution license in waterworks. In 2012, the field superintendent retired, and I applied for that position. I was awarded the field superintendent's position in July of 2012. At this point, it's 7 divisions with 46 staff members. Working for me, and here we are today.
Do you have much knowledge in the water system, filtration system that we have in place?
Knowledge of yours, no, but as far as Greenfield, yes. We maintain the filter beds and the pump houses.
But
that would be part of my first tour, I would hope, if I was offered the position.
Greenfield's a conventional filter bed, isn't it?
Yeah, it's out. We have 2 inside beds at Oak Hill, and we have 2 outside beds down off Eunice Williams Drive. That those have to be cleaned frequently, obviously. The trickling filters, outside filters.
So buildings, we talk a lot about buildings around here. Do you have any, give us any experience you have with actual buildings, municipal buildings mostly?
Just recently, 3 years ago, Greenfield formed their own division of building maintenance. But before that time, we were responsible for our own buildings in the DPW. I was directly responsible for the transfer station as far as the upkeep, maintenance, major repairs. Down the yard, as the field superintendent, we're responsible for the whole yard, the plumbing, heating, roofing, inspections, safety, and basically was all taken up by central maintenance 3 years ago. But in the past, yes, I've had experience and background in municipal buildings.
How did your central maintenance conversion go?
It actually went pretty smooth. It started out where the DPW director was wearing both hats. So the transition was pretty smooth because we were overseeing our own buildings anyways. And then incorporating, you know, hiring a central maintenance director, once that happened, and you brought the schools and all the other buildings into the mix. Most of the legwork was done on the program right through the DPW director. And now that it's up and running and it's been going pretty smoothly for a couple of years, it's actually really good. The DPW doesn't have to drop a lot of what they're doing to go fix something in a building or whatnot, so.
Good. Sharon retired, and that kind of changed that, didn't it? Yeah.
Do you have any questions for us?
Well, I asked a few questions in the initial interview. One of the things I wanted to ask is, and I asked it in the initial interview, was about a pavement management program, which from what I understand, you don't have a pavement management program here. We just recently had one put in place in Greenfield. We thought we had a really good pavement program. At the end of the day, it was pretty good, but the investing in that program was really an eye-opener to what's really going on with the roads out there. So that was one of my questions.
What system did you use in Greenfield?
I went through Beta.
Okay.
Beta came in and, you know, did the whole analysis. And
do you have any other questions for us?
I don't think so. I've done a lot of homework on the website. I think the most important thing is if I was offered the position, I got a lot of hands-on homework to do.
Downtown's smaller than Greenfield.
Yes. That was part of the attraction to the job, too. Population 18,000 in Greenfield. I know more than 5,000, so I do pride myself on customer service. You know, I believe in communicating with the taxpayer and making sure that their issues and complaints are acceptable resolutions.
Scale 1 to 10, you feel your computer literacy is about a number what? 1 being poor and 10 being great.
6.5, 7. I'm not a spreadsheet guru, but I do what I need to do on the computer.
Okay. So is there any other questions we have?
Pleasure to meet you.
It's a pleasure being here. I appreciate it.
All right.
Do make a motion to offer Marlo the Warner the job of our DPW superintendent.
Subject to
contract negotiations.
Second.
You sure about that?
Shy.
Okay. Any more discussion? All right, all those in favor?
Aye.
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 Welcome.
So Mr. Nixon will be getting in touch with you to set up some time to talk about some...
You got an update?
We renewed your contract.
He can do it, but if you could just do that, the Chief Huckowitz.
I got that, but how about how's Tom doing? We got power everywhere or not?
Yes, there's a few locations that have power out right now. Rocky Hill Road at River Drive. There's a power line across the road. Still have a vehicle off the road across from the church shack. Power's out at Mountain Farms. Most other areas are okay, but we have five trucks out right now.
Yeah, wind?
We've got two closed roads, right?
It's just a small section of Rocky Hill at River, so they can still take E Street. But be cautious, there's a lot of debris in the road. If folks can stay home right now, please do.
Mostly wind problems?
All wind problems, yes.
We need your contract, you're all set.
Wait a minute.
Thanks, Chief.
I would introduce myself.
Oh,
yeah.
He's busy.
All right. So, so we made the motion and subject to negotiations to hire him.
Okay,
so
thank you.
You'll be contacting him and then we'll be going from there.
All right, tomorrow morning.
Okay.
All right.
So thank you very much.
Welcome. Thank you.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Nice to meet you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Is it okay for my notes?
Sure.
Yes.
Sure.
All right. So.
Would you like to meet, does he know the building inspector is sitting behind you? Tim Neihart.
Electrical inspector?
Electrical inspector.
Electrical inspector.
Honorable Willie. Dan Linko.
Jack, citizen extraordinaire.
And we have two.
Actually, we're not.
Stop.
Nice try. Golden Court.
Two people that you want to stay really in contact with is the Finance Committee on opposite ends of you here. Mark Kilpacki and Amy Fiden. And there was a couple more on the Finance Committee, but they're not here. But it's a good start for you to get to know them.
And segue into our next appointment, we have the Finance Committee to talk about our schedule for reviewing the budget and how we want to do it this year.
If I may, we're still in a little bit of flux with that. We're trying to iron out all our schedules. Preliminary plan is the Saturday morning venue at the Public Safety Complex. We have done it in the past. Saturday's morning seems to work out well because most department heads are free. We're kind of fresh. We're not coming up an 8-hour day. We can usually do four departments at a session. So we're looking at probably four or five sessions, and then the rebuttal after that, and then be ready for town meeting.
Okay, so do we want to do the tri-board type meetings as well?
You're welcome to come and join us. If you want us to just grind it out, we're more than happy to do it.
Do you know when you're going to be starting the Saturdays, Mark?
We're going to have a preliminary Saturday meeting at 1 o'clock on the 13th.
Yeah. At
1
o'clock? So you're not doing mornings?
Or is that just
the preliminary one?
Yeah. Okay. We try to clear it over.
Okay, so then if we... how do we want to do the meetings we have? Do we want to schedule and do it after the Finance Committee, or start with the first meet, the last meeting in February with that's the question.
Yeah.
Let me just remind you of the schedule that you set for yourself. So you're meeting tonight, meeting next Wednesday, and then you decided that you didn't want to meet during a school break week, so we don't have a meeting on the 17th. Did agree to meet on the 24th.
We did agree to meet on the 24th.
Is that a question or
we did?
Okay.
We did.
Okay.
I don't remember that.
We're taking the other one again.
Hello. I thought we were only having two meetings.
I'll bring you back
month.
A present. Okay.
From New Zealand. Thank you. A kangaroo.
A kiwi.
Kiwi.
A kangaroo from New Zealand?
Sure.
No, they're in Australia.
I know.
Okay.
Go through there. Most people think that those two are the same countries anyway, but they're not.
So what do we want to try to do here for us?
Well, one of the things we were talking about last time is, I mean, what opportunity are we going to have to... we were talking about the fact that we did these SWOT analyses, and then the select board kind of use that to inform our own opinion of where we feel that we may need to apply resources, you know, our priorities are for the town. And at some point that information needs to kind of formally make its way to you, I would think, so that you have some context at least for where we're coming from.
Yep.
So that you're not just kind of...
Yep. You're the policy people. We'll figure out a way how to buy it.
So
I
mean,
how do we plan to go about that?
I know.
Right.
So
when will the meetings be over? We can bring that information back in house when the meetings are over.
Well, if they take 4 weeks to do it, and they start on the...
Let's see how we wind up with our preliminary run through, and then we can go ahead and have a meeting, and we can start to look at the greater priorities.
All right, so we know definitely we want to talk to public safety.
Right.
We know definitely we want to talk to the schools.
Yes.
So do we just want to go ahead and schedule for us to have public safety come in the end of February to talk to us?
Mm-hmm.
Or you can come in when we have them scheduled
go through their line item.
I think it'd be, I mean, why should we make them do it twice?
Well, we have some issues with public safety. We are supporting that we need to work out how we're going to support those.
Right.
So it's not so much them going through the line items with us as how we wish to address some of the discussions we've had with them.
So will you have a number when you start your?
Well, preliminary number, but we've got to go through everybody's budget to see where we are, where as a town we stand at the net, before we should begin discussions on other projects.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, I would think that we would want to go ahead and have a discussion with public safety. I mean, I think there are a lot of management and staffing and things that we need to talk about with them, that it would then be helpful to, you know, whatever the outcome is there, then hand off to the finance committee. So that they, again, we're just all playing with the same piece of information.
Yeah. The capital planning committee should be in on that too, right?
Potentially, yeah. Some of it's staffing, which isn't in capital.
So the department's put together budgets based upon your instructions. Mm-hmm. They've also put in the program enhancements as per your instructions. Mm-hmm. And I think the finance committee is going to look at the departmental budget, but I think you're talking about the select board has to make a decision about the program enhancements and whether this is something that you're going to support and how much of it are you going to support. And that needs to be communicated to the finance committee, so we're really operating off the same piece of paper.
Correct, but you gotta do it, I mean, unless we do it at the same time or we line things up that we go first and then talk to, and then pass it on to them, which we could do.
I think that's the way we have to do it.
So then that actually leads ourselves to, I mean, if they're, I'm trying to read the calendar. So if they're meeting on the
13th is just an organizational preliminary meeting.
So you
want to get a grip on this. Mm-hmm.
So we're not going to meet before the next Saturday.
Right.
So the department that you wanted to meet with first is DPW.
Right.
So
perfect.
So that would work out perfectly that on the 24th the select board can meet with public safety. In the meantime, you're working with DPW, and we can go from there.
Okay. So you have a rough schedule already, then, how you want to line the departments up?
Yeah, just barely, in my own mind.
Okay.
Yeah. But we're going to work that out on that Saturday.
Okay. Yeah. So that's the way to go, then. Mm-hmm. So then we'll take the last meeting in February and the first and second meetings in March. And we'll see if the school committee can come in maybe the first meeting in March or the second meeting in March.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And I will attempt to go to as many of the finance committee meetings as I can.
You go ahead and beat them up first.
Beat up who?
Oh, come on. You're so good at it, Mark.
I was digging the rock in it old school, tell you the truth. But
it certainly is a little different because it was, I don't know if it was easy or not. I guess this year it'll tell of not being able to have them in with us both at the same time because we've been doing that for the last 3 years. So it's a little bit, this is the old way of doing it now, I guess, this is what we're going back to, which is okay, so you can get a handle on it.
Yeah, we just want to get a firm grip on it and where we are, and then we'll come back to you and
talk about it.
We'll talk about it.
Yeah, exactly.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So the numbers changed. On January 20th, I presented my budget, and the governor came out with his budget recommendation, and the schools revised their budget figures. So the numbers changed by $100,000, and I've given you an update of where we are, $100,000 to the good. We're going to see the House Ways and Means budget next, House budget, Senate Ways and Means, Senate budget. And my question to the board is, do you want to be kept up to speed as to how the budget changes every time these various committees meet, or do you want to set a line in the sand and say, this is the number we're going to run with?
I thought we had decided we're setting the line in the sand and saying this is what we're running with, and then as knowing that when we get all the way through, then we do have this, we may have more, we may have less. Mm-hmm. So that's kind of, I thought, how we decided to do it. We can change it and keep updating it every time we do it, but.
Are you open to suggestions? If we change it, let's change it one day a week and only one day a week, and if you want it to be whatever's convenient for David, so that everybody's working off a Thursday the 13th numbers till we get to Thursday the 20th numbers. So that we're not getting changes in between, you know, if you get something in the morning and at night when we come here to a meeting, we have another number that we're working off of. Let's pick a drop dead date. Let's use the numbers at that point in time, and let's, if you're gonna adjust them, let's adjust them weekly, not daily.
I would propose.
I actually prefer adjusting it once, as we get close to town meeting, whatever.
That was our suggestion, was to just shortly before town meeting, take a reassessment and get as accurate as we can.
All right, so then we're gonna use what we have today, which is dated.
So that would be the governor's House 2 numbers.
So January 20th, 2016.
Right.
Showing a tentative $600,000 deficit.
Right.
Yep.
Okay, and then, so 128-2016 is the spreadsheet we're gonna use, and we're not gonna change it for a while.
Right.
Agreed?
Yep.
Thank you for that clarification. I'll certainly keep you up to speed if I think there's any trouble out there.
Well, we're hearing all sorts of great stuff.
Half a million would be great, too.
Really?
Yeah, I mean, the House, the Senate saying they want to add more money to schools. I mean, we've already.
UMass.
Yeah, not UMass.
Yeah. What they say and what they do are two different things.
They come up with a consensus.
I don't know.
How do you believe them?
We also got the new, I mean, this is Stan's first year.
We're hoping.
UMass is woefully underfunded already.
Yeah, we got to talk to him about that. But, okay, so we got our schedule together, how we're going to do it. Mm-hmm. So we're going to start with public safety at the end of this month and ask the schools if they can come in one of the next two in March. Mm-hmm. And then we'll adjust if, mm-hmm. All right?
DPW too.
Yep.
They'll start with the finance committee.
All right. That sound, everybody's in agreement?
Yes.
Looking for the audience to shake their heads too.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay. Not fall asleep.
Okay.
That would be me.
All right. I think we're in agreement.
Okay, thank you for that clarification.
All right, is there anything else we want to talk about the meetings? No?
Are we all set with the finance? You got anything else for us? Okay.
Okay.
Perfect.
We're
looking forward to getting underway.
Thanks.
Thank you for doing it, both of you. And the other members too. It's super.
6-1.
It's hard to jump around on the computer. So Commonwealth Compact, we need to designate a signatory because I'm gonna be out of town and they're coming. They're coming next
week.
6.2, new business.
That's the one at City Hall?
City Hall, that's right.
Yeah, I can attend the City Hall thing.
You can do the City Hall thing?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so we're going to designate Ms. Keegan to sign for us for the Commonwealth Compact program, which is one of Governor Baker's new programs. Did he talk much about it at MMA?
No, he didn't.
No, he did. He mentioned it.
He mentioned it.
But he didn't belabor it.
Okay.
Yeah.
So it's supposed to be to help bring together people to come up with some new innovative ideas and maybe do some sharing and some
best
consolidating
practices.
And best practice types of things.
Mm-hmm. Right. So we put in for two projects under Commonwealth Compact. First one was technical assistance to help develop a stronger financial management team and infuse it with best management practices. And the other is technical assistance to develop a safe routes to school program for the town of Hadley.
All right, so is there a motion to?
So moved.
Second.
All right, any more discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Congratulations.
No, thank you.
All right, new business 6.3, we talked about the Bay Road Bridge and the pending weight reduction and lane closure.
Right, so, well, on January 21st, we've had received informal notice from the Massachusetts Department of Transportation District 2, which is over in Northampton, that a recent inspection of the bridge over the Four River on Bay Road revealed that the bridge is in need of repairs. We were given informal notice, an advance notice, that the bridge would be closed down to one lane and signaled, and that the weight restriction would be reduced on that bridge to 3 tons. So this is obviously a concern for us. There are two ways to get to the southern part of town. Both of them involved crossing the Four River on bridges, and we're losing one of our bridges. The good news is that this is a state project. It's a state bridge, and it's on them to do the construction and to pay for it. So this should not result in a direct financial impact to the town of Hadley, taxpayers, or to the town government. But we are concerned about the potential restriction on that bridge, both in terms of emergency response, school bus routes, snow plowing strategy, and just general traffic congestion. We have not received the formal notice of this action on the bridge, but that could come at any time. Apparently the MassDOT is waiting for an inspection report, and as soon as they get that, they'll start implementing the changes to the bridge. We'll have a couple of days to ramp up because they'll have to put in the signalization, the signage. Your emergency management team met this morning in order to get a public service announcement out, as well as to work in conjunction with MassDOT to get this information out as far and wide as possible, including signage on I-91 north and south in order to direct truck traffic away from Bay Road. We've been in contact with our mutual aid partners, as well as any service that uses Bay Road as a principal route for emergency response, including Belchertown Ambulance and Granby Ambulance. So we're trying to get the word out, and we're trying to coordinate with our mutual aid partners, as well as PBTA and with the state, in order to make this as painless as possible and make this work as best as possible. I think there's no getting around that this is going to be an inconvenience for many people, and we'll just try to mitigate the effects as much as possible. If it's a public safety issue, if the bridge truly is in bad shape, we absolutely do not want to do anything that would put people in jeopardy. But at the same time, if we can make this as easy as possible for people to live with, that's what we're going to do.
Dave, any notion in what the duration of the project would be?
We do not know.
Okay.
We've had a lot of conversations with people from down that end of town that are very concerned that this project drag out to be something that's 3 years long, because we see bridges everywhere now that are being inspected and shut down, whether it's in South Deerfield or whether, you know, we're talking about our consent agenda bridge for earlier this evening. We're going to be on an island pretty soon. And that the concern is that there's so much traffic that's coming down 47 coming into Hadley that way, that if that bridge is shut down, that, and it was a lighted signal going across there, they're afraid that people are not going to be able to turn even up to go up Bay Road, and even to go to 116 to get back, that because there's so much traffic that goes that way in the morning. So the concern is that the engineering and everything else gets done in a timely manner. And if there's any other opportunity, whether we can, you know, plank that road or put, you know, plates on that road in order so that we can continue it while the engineering's going on, so that we can still have two-way traffic. We know it's going to take a while to rebuild the bridge. We completely understand that. But we don't want that bridge shut down for 3 years. We've got to do whatever we can do.
But they kind of moved the, there was two bridges I'm
the one that
more
burned.
Aware of. No, I'm talking about the bridge in Amherst that they
Meadow
had
Street.
One lane down and up back and forth, and it seemed traffic went through there fairly decent with the lights that they put up. And then the other one was on 5 and 10 in Northampton going to Holyoke.
Yeah, but the bigger issue for us on this bridge is the weight restriction.
Because
three tons is a small pickup. mean, there's people in Hadley who have trucks that are over 3 tons.
My work trucks are over 3 tons.
So they have to go around, and that's, so this is my,
I won't have as much traffic going by my house on Bay Road.
You'll have more. You're going to have far more.
No, they won't go anywhere.
They won't go anywhere.
Can't go anywhere. They got to go, they're coming from Amherst to cross over Fort River to go to Hampton.
They're going the other way. They're going to take a right, and they're going to go past you and go to 116.
So, I mean, the one thing, if you live up that direction, I mean, 3 years is going to be quick. I mean, we're just talking about buildings taking 5 to 10 years. This bridge is a pretty big bridge, and it's going to take 3 years seriously to do. And there's not going to be anything they do to give us any type of temporary bridge unless they take it out and put a Bailey Bridge in or something, which I doubt they'll probably do that. I mean, I really haven't seen the report, so. And they probably have, they provided a report to us?
No, once we get the report, they're going to implement the, I'm told they're going to implement the lane closure and weight restrictions. So kind of good news that we haven't got the report yet.
Well, I was just curious what it said. Yeah. That tells you more about why. I mean, it sounds like they're saying the outer two stringers, or outer two beams are no good anymore. And that you can only go in the center. There's probably three in the center.
And so. I'm told there's telephone poles under there.
Well,
B&M Construction, I remember doing that years ago.
All right.
After the fire.
Yeah.
So it's going to be a long time. We just have to stay on top of Mass Highway to keep moving it along, because it is going to divert a lot of traffic down 116 and our neighbor, and then a lot of traffic is going to come down through Route 9 and. Route 9 is going to get bottled up more than it gets bottled up now.
And we got a big project going next summer on Route 9.
Yes.
So is that something our legislators can help with?
Something that they can probably push, but the state's got to be willing to push
it. How about the culvert on 47? River
Drive. That's in good shape still.
That's in still good.
Yeah, we just hadn't looked at it. The state is okay with that.
We were just down there.
So just
should we bother to contact Rosenberg and Sybic's office?
I think we should. I don't know that political pressure is what's needed right now. I think working in conjunction with MassDOT is the best way to go right now.
It's funny to me that we go from inspecting bridges to we got to shut it down. There's one lane. And this is Chicken Little stuff to me. That, you know, they do inspections of bridges all the time. I can't imagine we went from, you know, that bridge is perfectly fine to have tractor trailers worth of fuel oil going over them at 23 tons to now we're down to 3 tons. It just doesn't make any sense to me.
Jerry, that bridge was flagged 20 years ago. It was paying for it.
Yeah, it has.
They just didn't have the money to fix them, and now they're trying to play catch up. The big problem is this state takes way too long to fix these bridges. You look at Maryland, the Naples Bay Bridge, when that was shut down, they had that fixed and redone in 18 months. Why does it take this state so long to redo a simple, tiny little bridge?
Every time I go out to the Cape and ride over the Sagamore Bridge and see it took 3 years to build, I don't know why the Coolidge Bridge took 4.
Yeah, it's this is a weird state. They don't do things that other states' DOTs do. I mean, it's a simple span bridge. It should just be a in
it's
and out.
It's cookie book stuff.
And this comes up at every Selectmen's Association or if the regional Selectmen's meeting, somebody's complaining about a horror story with the state related to bridge work. So in terms of reaching out to Rosenberg and Sybic, I'm not necessarily thinking that they're going to call the DOT and ask them to move it along, you know, fellas, but approaching the governor to say, you know, you want efficiency and improvement, and you want to help the municipalities, this is a great place for us to pressure them.
It is.
It's ridiculous.
But then what they're going to tell us is we have a new Secretary of Transportation.
Yeah.
And we have a new organization at our office, and they're working on it.
It doesn't hurt to be a squeaky wheel.
I agree.
Okay, so we're going to send a letter?
I think we should send a letter, and I think we should call.
So we'll do that, but then everyone should just be prepared. This is going to be long.
Yep.
Yeah, I mean, we got a few more minutes.
We'll get one more agenda.
Well, I'll be quick. I mean, the one thing people have to realize is that everyone's worried about being the next Flint, Michigan, or being the next person that did something wrong and didn't catch it. That's what everybody's worried about, because as you said earlier, you can litigate anything.
Yeah.
And that's what everybody's scared of. So when they make these decisions and someone says, yes, you should close it, no one really above them is going to say, no, you shouldn't, because then it's their neck on the line for the litigation.
But we're talking about, again, proven track records in states other than Massachusetts that they can turn these things around effectively and efficiently.
But Massachusetts says it better.
Okay, let's just send the letters in.
We've had a good time now.
We got that down pat.
All right, so that's all. Any more discussion?
Nope.
All right.
Thank you.
So the last item we have for our new business is the environmental bond bill.
Okay, so we got the good news from the state that Hadley was a recipient of an SRF loan, which is a subsidized loan for the Route 9 water main replacement project. I think we received $379,000 potential to be borrowed at a 2% interest rate over a 20-year period. The bids for the project came in far below that at $217,210. Which is a very favorable price. If you remember, at the October town meeting, we authorized borrowing at $377,000 for that project. So taking these numbers and going to the chief financial advisor, he said, take the 2% for 20 years. It's much more favorable. And we should rescind at the annual town meeting the $377 borrowing authorization. Because it simply won't be needed.
Yeah, but you've got 217 now. That's not a drop dead number, is it?
That's the bid number.
Is that with a 10% contingent in it? Built in already?
I believe it is not.
So what if they come in over budget?
So we have $379.
Not if we rescind it on the floor.
There are two borrowings here. So there's the borrowing for $377, which we've already authorized.
Yeah.
Then there would be the second borrowing under the SRF program for at 2% for $379 or some other lower amount. So we should borrow at 2% rather than the higher interest rate. We just have to rescind our previous borrowing because it stays on the book as a bond authorization and we won't need it.
So you're not changing the number, you're changing the method?
Yeah.
Yes.
I understand.
Picking it out of a different pocket.
Okay.
So we'll go through that. Senator Rosenberg, who announced the release of the SRF program, said that the environmental bond bill of 2014 contained much more money for Hadley than what was authorized under the SRF. There's an additional $850,000 that's potentially available to the town of Hadley for infrastructure improvements. Senator Rosenberg recommended that we write a letter to the Secretary of DEP with a carbon copy to Senator Rosenberg asking for the release of the additional money. When we put together our original request back in 2014, we were thinking of not only the waterline replacement, and we had a different planning number at that point, but also improvements at the sewer wastewater treatment plant. And so looking at the next three projects that are listed in our capital plan for the wastewater treatment plant, we have $513,000 of capital improvements that could be, we could apply that additional bond money for. So I've prepared a letter for your signature asking for the release of $513,000 for sewer repairs under the environmental bond bill.
So moved. Is there a second?
Second.
So any more discussion?
Do you want to put the number of 519, or, you know, again, we're pigeonholing that. If there's 800 available and you think 519 is the number, should it be 600? At least for the request,
I have four projects. The one on the bottom was $850,000. That's for sludge handling improvements. I have three other projects that total the 517. It would be the septage handling improvements, the aeration tank splitter, and the SCADA system. So I think given that the septage improvements, these tank splitters, the aeration tank splitters and the SCADA systems are a higher priority than the sludge handling improvements. I think that's what we should go for. I can change it, the number to the sludge handling improvements for the 850 if you wish.
I just don't want you to be short.
Yeah.
When you're doing this.
So you have to be very specific as to the project that you're requesting the funds for? Is that the issue?
It makes it defensible.
Right, you can't just say, give me everything you got.
No, but with every project you bid, there's a 10% contingency that can be built into it.
Right, that should be.
So if that's not in there, let's build it in.
Okay.
So add the 51, so, please. Amendment to the motion.
All right.
Friendly amendment to the motion.
Friendly.
Any more discussion? Are all those in favor?
Aye.
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 Okay, thank you.
All right. Look at this, it's 8 o'clock and it's not time for our 8 o'clock appointment.
On the dot. I moved you right along, nice.
We would've got there anyhow. Okay.
Yeah, but we got everything.
We did. So for our 8 o'clock appointment, we've invited the senior center, the library trustees, and the municipal building committee in here to have a discussion about moving forward. So, as we wait for everybody to come in and get settled in.
So you have some visuals, is that all right?
Yes,
yeah,
that's fine.
Let him have that chair.
Oh, for sure.
Oh.
You can pull the chair out.
Everybody. Hi, how are
you? No one wants to sit up front.
Somebody gonna come see me?
It's kind of like sitting in church.
Yes, of course they are. Whoever's looking last year.
Okay, Connie Mitch?
Yeah.
Okay.
If she can get away.
If all she right. can't, just let me know. I'll
okay.
be I'll be down.
So before we get started, my cold is starting to act up more and more now that I've been going through this meeting. So if I stop talking, that's what's going on. So just keep it going. And I apologize. I'm almost out of tea too, so it could be a little last minute. Okay, so the purpose of this meeting was we wanted to bring this.
Power outage happened.
Yeah, it must have just switched. So the purpose of this meeting is for us to sit down and talk about how we're going to move forward with everything in the building world we have going on and what we think we want to do here. Let you guys talk a little bit about what your programs are going on, library, senior center. I really, after a meeting with the building committee Tuesday before, I really think we're in a better position to actually move everything along and have numbers at town meeting so people can know what the total impact will be at the annual town meeting. We have more information than we knew we had. It's just the information was in different pockets all over town, which is common. So with that said, who would like to go first?
Go ahead.
Well, let's have the library go first.
Okay.
And talk a little more about their project.
Sure. Okay, so my name is Patrick Rosen. I'm the director of the library. So thank you for having us tonight. A few things I mentioned at the previous appearance, the presentation that we put on with all of the boards and departments. You may hear a couple of things that you've heard before, but they're worth repeating, and I'll try to keep it brief. But the main thing is that our building is 113 years old. It has not been renovated in any significant way in that time. The population has tripled in the time since it opened, and we're really struggling to provide service under the conditions that we're working in. Another important thing to remember is that in the last 10 years alone, we have seen a 250% increase in circulation of items from our library. That's up to now 9 items per capita. So under the circumstances that we're facing, it's not really possible for us to provide the kind of adequate service that one would reasonably expect from a public library in a population that's also expected to grow to 6,500 within 20 years. So at that point, you know, instead of circulating 46,000 items, we'd be circulating close to 60,000 items if we just remained stable at 9 per capita.
So that's just, that's a lot of material flowing through our building. So as everyone knows here probably, we got a planning and design grant close to 2 years ago. We've been working with the architects Johnson Roberts Associates. They have started working with us to put together schematic designs for the proposed library. I have those here. We didn't have a chance to talk about those at the last meeting, but if we have time, I'll just go through them really quickly. So as you can see here, this building is situated on the current site of the senior center. You can see that this is the current library here. So you can see that relative to the library, it's right next door. This is the intersection of this is Middle Street. This is Route 9, Russell Street, right here. Some of the things to consider about this siting of the library. There are 40 parking spaces here. We currently have, I believe, 9. This is a vast improvement. These are quite often completely full. So we have plenty of extra parking capacity here. The building is clearly visible from the intersection of Russell and Middle Streets, just like the library is now. So it's still a very prominent location. It's close to public transportation. There's a bus stop right here. That's very important for our patron base, as well as people who work at the library. So in this new design, you'll see that there is a welcoming southern-facing entrance to the building. The rear of the site, still there is still a large area that could be developed for another town department, whether that's senior center or something else. That's still available. The interior, let me just switch to the next visual here. This is the schematic of the interior of the building. And as you can see, the main features of the building here are the large public meeting room, which can hold up to 75 people. It can be accessed by the public if there's a reservation for it after hours. This is the inner door that can be locked to secure the library so that people can enter here, use the restrooms here, and then the building can be locked on the outside at the end of the night. So this is a huge feature. We get calls weekly at the library asking for meeting space. We don't have it. Most modern libraries these days do. And there really aren't many alternatives for public meeting spaces that we can point them to in town. So that's a big selling point of this design. Another thing that you'll notice that is different from what we have now is we have distinct spaces here for children, young adults, adult materials. And these are, you know, areas that can be, doors can be closed to contain noise. We have no way to really, you know, separate what children are doing, the noise that they're making right here with, you know, adult conversation over here or whatever, quiet reading. So this is a huge improvement in terms of the way we can lay the library out and the collections and activities. So another feature here, we have a programming room off of the children's room that can be used for story hours, activities. There would be an exterior door here leading out onto a patio area that could be used in nice weather for other kinds of programming. And we have a collection area that allows us to double our holdings. Right now we're holding 20,000, roughly 20,000 physical items. We'd be able to hold close to 40,000 physical items, which would be roughly what we should be at for a town of this size. So the next thing, we have some figures for the cost of this project that were given to us this week by the architects. The preliminary estimated cost of the project is roughly $5 million. And the way that would be spent or paid for is as follows. So the Board of Library Commissioners will provide a grant for this project, assuming it meets their approval, that would cover as much as 54% of the cost. So that's $2.7 million, or more than half. So on top of that, the library's capital campaign hopes to raise $500,000, or 10% of the total. Leaving the cost to the town $1.8 million, or 36% of the total cost, just over a third for the total cost of the building. And that seems like a very attractive opportunity. So the last thing I'd like to mention is the timeline, which I mentioned at the last meeting, but I'd like to just quickly go over it one more time. So in May, the trustees hope to get a three-part vote at annual town meeting. The first part of that vote, well, it could possibly be a four-part, but I'll get to that in a moment. The first part is the authorization to use the Hooker School site. The second is a vote of support for the trustees of the library to apply to the MDLC for the construction grant. The third is approval of the preliminary design, which should look more or less like this. It may have some changes, but it's really taking shape, and the architects are mostly done with their job. And there's a fourth possible component that David Nixon may be able to tell us more about, involving the designation of the site as a school and needing to be maybe changed to that of a library. I don't know if you have anything to add about that at some point. But the application for the grant is due January 2017. It's awarded July 2017. And in fall 2017, at town meeting, we will be looking for a vote to accept the grant and to fund the remainder of the project. And construction could begin at earliest spring of 2019, but more likely 2020. So
one question.
Sure.
Which relates to the money.
Yeah.
Is it locked in at this point for the price, or is it going to be a variable for 2017?
This is supposed to include, if I recall correctly, an escalation for the price between now and when the construction would actually start. Mm-hmm.
So then the reimbursement rate, you're pretty sure it's 50?
We have been told by the MDLC they have a formula for this where, actually I have it here somewhere, wherein for the first, let's see if I can find it. Basically, I've gotten it literally on direct authority from the MDLC that it would be 54% for our case, in a case where the construction is $5 million. That's what I'm told. So, I mean, I can show you the formula if you'd like, but that's what I've been told.
The construction's $5 million. How about the incidentals? I mean, we need to put buildings in there. We need to put shelves in there. We need to put seats, computers. What's the total number we're looking at here?
I don't actually have numbers for that. Do you have something from the estimate?
It includes
furnishings.
It includes some of the furnishings, not some of the others. All the shelving is part of the funding. So other things, some of the soft furnishings are not. Obviously, we try to reuse as much as we could from our old library, but yes, that is another consideration.
Right, and some of the funds that in trusts that have been in the care of the library have been held on to for enhancing.
Kate Nugent's money, some other things like that.
Yes.
So at this point, we feel of that $500,000, we already have a piece of that because we have Kate's money and we have some other funds we've saved. So we're kind of excited to launch our capital campaign saying we already have some money.
Any other questions from the board?
How's the processes work for this? We go to town meeting, there's overrides that need to go on this? It's just a town meeting vote that approves or disapproves?
At this point in May?
Yeah.
No, in May
we're just talking about, you know, what we're looking at and is the town willing to, you know, use the building space,
right,
et cetera.
Right.
Okay. Let's be clear. So the three or four votes that the library is going to seek right now is a simple majority vote. At the time when we have to raise the additional money that's not covered by the grant, then that would be a debt exclusion vote. So that would be a two-thirds majority with a ballot question to follow.
We made this just for you. We hope to have you at the
special
library.
Anyone. Thank you.
They're just kind of reiterating what Patrick said. There are 10 facts about the library, and then the timeline again on the back. Sorry. I'm sorry we didn't make enough for the whole audience who didn't realize.
I have one of these already. Does anybody else?
Is that Mark back there?
Sure. Thanks.
See if we can get one still.
Mark.
I hear
Mark.
Yes, that's Mark.
Does the estimate include the demolition cost and if there's any potential environmental issues from the demolition?
It does include the demolition, whether
in terms of environmental costs, I don't know what is in the building.
Do they actually have a breakdown of all the items yet?
No.
No.
And that way we still they have a construction grant, I mean, construction drawings where you would have the cost estimated.
They haven't done any feasibility number. I mean, you have a number, mm-hmm. but there's not a feasibility breakdown of what those numbers are made up of.
So they have done a rough per square footage
yes.
cost, and they've done a rough estimation of how much the demolition would cost. But that's,
that number.
Yeah, yeah, right.
So they have, so the numbers are, okay.
Right, on this schematic design.
On this design.
And
right.
this site is what that number
relates to. Okay, all right. So do we have any, does the finance committee have any questions?
I just asked about the demolition cost and turnaround cost.
Right.
We'll have to pass muster at town meeting.
It will. So is anybody in the audience who had a question for about the library part of this?
Well, what are we going to do at the senior center?
I said about the library.
I know.
Let me ask the question again. Is there anybody in the audience who has a question about the library?
Well, it does put to, he does have a point there.
Well, wait a minute.
No,
we'll
get to
it.
To that. He does have a point.
All right. So with the senior center, I'd like to talk about what they're envisioning as the type of program they would need for moving.
For moving?
Or the future.
So what a perfect senior center would look like for Hadley, according to what I've looked at. I've done some talking with architects. I've sat in a couple conferences about building. I've forwarded a lot of that information to the building committee. I have sat down and filled out a space needs analysis based on the major components that I see that are necessary for a senior center, based on common practices and what we already have. I took the DRA study for what we had for square footage and then looked at whether that was working or not, and then tweaked those figures appropriately to reflect all of the elements we needed and how much space we'd need to give a basic estimate. I had that figure validated by an architect with the projected figures for the population or our demographic growth all the way out to 2030. And it came down to 10,000 square feet. So I've passed that along. I think we're in the right place at the right time if they have an opportunity and Hadley is willing. I remember answering your question once before at a select board meeting when you said, how do I feel about this whole thing? And I said, well, it's going to need to be done at some point. I'm looking at this as an exercise to, you know, see how that could be done and what would be needed. And if we're at that point, I'm happy for the seniors because they would love it.
So the number, well, the 10,000, it's actually 13,000 when you figure in hallways and all the incidentals.
Correct.
And that was pretty much what you gave to the building committee, and you're pretty satisfied with that?
I did look at the cost-based estimate and had a couple comments on that, acknowledging, first and foremost, it was great that he could do that for us. It had a lot, if not most, of the elements that I had done in the first pass of my space needs estimate. Some tweaking needs to be done, like the large multi-purpose room. He
and
had down
1,000 square feet.
Yep, 1,024. Even if you added the small multi-purpose room with it, you're only looking at 1,400. And right now,
Guilford, you have?
Right now we have, oh, I'm sorry.
No, I'm sorry, just you have information we don't have, or?
No, this was sent to us all.
That's from the email?
Yes.
Okay, all right.
Currently we have 3,200 between where we have our exercise programs and the dining hall, and we need at least a third bigger for exercise.
We've had to add a whole other day of the same exercise program because we've had Tuesdays and Thursdays where it's maxed out for over 3 years. So clearly we need a bigger space for that. So that those things will need to be looked at insofar as can we, you know, shift some of the offices so that we're doing dual purpose depending on who's there, not full time, things like that, and allocate a little bit more space there. I think that we can really look at those things as we move forward. But certainly the plan that he put together with the conceptual estimate has most of, if not all of, the elements that we need.
Is there any questions from the board?
I don't think Suzanne's telling you she's an architect and is drawing this out either. I think she's telling, you know, based on the best information she has available to us, she's trying to give answer your question to the best of her ability.
Exactly.
Which she doesn't have renderings and drawings. So.
That's my disclaimer. Thank you.
So my thoughts are, how much is this going to take up on the property?
$10,000.
How much? Well, roughly give me an idea where the senior center is right now.
Half of
the same footprint.
The same footprint.
Well,
it's actually a little longer, I believe. I think the parking lot. I think the parking lot now ends about here.
I'm assuming that's a single story building.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
And how many square feet is that building?
11,000.
11,000.
Okay.
So we have the lot behind it.
Mm-hmm. Is that enough to actually just mirror image flat down?
Yeah.
Because we're going to need our own parking as well.
We had our architect look at that, and he gave us some sketches of what that could look like, and there was enough room on the lot, and also enough room to include ample parking for a second. So.
And what about the town's requirement for green space? A third of the land.
Well, we could always
talk to the planning.
We could ask for a waiver.
All right, just
no, the planning board. No, it's a good question.
Good question.
ZBA comes in somewhere there.
Do it now, not later.
But then let's not forget the Conservation Historical Commission, and everybody else will have to chime in on it too, I'm sure.
Historical.
That's what I said. I did say.
Oh, it sounded like it.
I did. Historical. I did say historical.
So, is there any other questions from the board?
Personally, what I would like to see there, and I said it before, mm-hmm. is a pod. You have the library, you have the senior center, and I would like to acquire more land in that area for Park and Rec, because we can't forget Park and Rec. They're a part of it, too. So in the realm of things, we still have the planning board and other people that use the, you know, mm-hmm. rooms, which I'm sure we can use community rooms for that as such. If we're looking at the whole total project, that's what I would like to look at. I think everybody deserves to have everything looked at this point. Not just the library and the senior center. I think Park and Rec is in there too. So if we're
it's gonna, actually in on this.
It's on this.
Right.
But I don't love that idea, and neither do they.
Well, no, it's not. It's
not, not
in the same
it's
building.
It's not the same building. They're,
yes.
They're separate buildings. But they're like pods, you know. You got the library.
Campus for the rest of us. For us non-medical people, it's a campus. For us medical people, it's pods.
Okay.
So
I'm good with that.
I'll translate.
I'm going with the pod.
I like the pod.
I'll go with that.
You know, whatever it takes.
So the seniors actually really do have their own.
That's the goal, and I think the way we look at this is that we would have a go with a campus type. I think we had a lot of talk about the campus type layout, pod layout. I think a whale's on here, pond, though. And then, yeah, there'd be the library, there'd be the senior center, there'd be Park and Rec. And if we choose something else to go in there, there might be something else in there. And then the discussion would be how to lay that all out and make it flow. I think the Municipal Building Committee is got some thoughts on that, and they're working on, you want to talk about it now, or do you want to?
Whatever your pleasure is.
We talk about it now.
Context.
I mean, that is one of the concepts that we actually started off with right from the very beginning, is some type of a campus approach. And there has been discussions with the possibility of obtaining land in and around right there. we don't want to just go by that scenario. We also want to, hopefully, when we put out an RFP or RFQ, whatever it's called, for land downtown here, is open it up a little bit more. That might not be the only place that somebody might want to give us some more, or sell us some more land. And we also have to look at the price. You know, it might be more favorable that we don't want to tie us into one area. We want to open it up and look at different areas of downtown. There are some other possibilities. So, you know, we need to think about getting that out on the streets soon so we can kind of pull, figure out which path would be the best. So, yes, and we all tend to agree that has to be done quickly. And that'll give us some idea. There is, and we're looking at more than that one approach of can we repurpose other buildings and switch some departments around. I think we all know it comes down to the numbers, the last dollars. So we'd like to look at more than one option, get some hard numbers to everybody, get some concept designs, and then present it and go from there. There's going to be benefits to each scenario. Everybody sort of likes this idea of doing the campus, and we're all for whatever seems to work the best and at the best dollars for everybody.
So based on that, we've kind of talked this out. The select board talked last meeting about this a little bit. I talked to the building committee two Tuesdays ago about this. So I think we're actually in really good shape. So what we had talked about doing is we definitely need to go ahead and put out an RFP for land. If we want to say the center and around the center, we definitely need to put that one out. And the town administrator started to work on that. We got a draft today.
Right, so you have a draft in your materials today of an RFP for land based upon the recommendations of the Municipal Building Committee, those chiefly being that the parcel be preferred, not required, but preferred to be 3 acres and located no farther than preferred again, no farther than 1 mile from the intersection of 47 and 9.
Okay, so we have that draft. We should circulate it to everybody, mm-hmm. let them make some comments on it, and try to have it back by our meeting on the 24th. So we'll email it to the Municipal Building Committee. We'll email it, would anybody else want in on this? We'll email it to everybody. Just if you have comments, get them back to the town administrator so we can actually probably wrap this up and then we can actually vote to put it out at the end of the month, which would be the 24th. Oh, I just can't see it. 24th. That's my birthday. Why can't I remember that? Oh, sorry. So we want to do that. So that's what we're going to do. So we'll put that out. That will give us the number for what the land cost will be. So we have that when we go in an annual town meeting and people, we can give people, this will be the cost of the land if we want to do this project. We do have a good estimate from the Municipal Building Committee they put together based on the needs assessment, needs of the senior center and the recreation. With this estimate, we're about $4.5 million for those two. So that actually, $5.5 million for those two. So that now triggers another thing we need to do, which is procure a owner's project manager, which is required by the state. And you do have to do that before you can actually hire a designer. So we talked about putting out a request for qualifications now, and then we'll get those in, and we'll have some prices, and then we'll have an owner's project manager, OPM, set up for annual town meeting. We'll have that number as well. So the other two outstanding things we need to have for town meeting, I think, which we actually have, or we will have shortly, is we're looking at possibly doing something in the north side of town for fire and maybe for park and rec up there. So we actually have one response to our request for information So we know the value of a piece of property up there we can use as a as our estimate for that. The only other thing we need is to know, do we truly have someone who wants the North Hadley Hall? That RFP is out on the streets now, and we'll have that information back. So as we're actually moving quite a lot here, if we think about it. But the library can keep moving forward with their project. They have their information, and we'll prepare that for town meeting. And we'll do our two RFPs and one RFQ to gather the information we need for the rest of the buildings, the other two projects.
You need the substation, fire substation.
Well, the fire station? Yes, that's part of that too. And then the Municipal Building Committee is going to wrap up their look at all the buildings and their analysis of what they recommend for the overall buildings. So we have that for the discussion about this as well. And sort of a ranking of where we need to go. That we talked about it 2 weeks ago. You're going to work on that. So I think we're in good shape. Mr. Nixon?
So the RFQ for the OPM has been circulated with the board, so if it's acceptable, I'll tighten it up and get that out with the timing of raising the money at the annual town meeting for that, so that we'll have that ready to go for June. The other part of this is everybody is wondering how we're going to afford this. Just speaking from strictly an administrative point of view, recognizing that other people other than I will make the decisions about how to spend money. But coming up in FY19, FY20, and FY21, we're going to be retiring a large amount of debt service. In that three-year period, we're going to retire $357,000 of debt service annual payments on debt. So that equates to an $8 million project if we're to fill that debt service back up again. One of our goals has always been to keep impact on taxes as level as possible, so we have an opportunity coming up in about 3 years' time, which is not a whole lot of time, in order to blend these projects into our capital spending plan.
So, Spyhard?
One of the things that we wanted to ask of you is that we were approached by someone else up in North Hadley that has recently just purchased property and wishes to possibly come into agreement with the town for land for the substation.
They want to donate? That was
donate.
The question.
It
donate.
Could very well be. So the issue is we had it out for land in North Hadley, and we're thinking that it might be wise to send it out again so we can get the response back.
RFP. Well, we put an RFI out, so if they wish to submit one late, it's up to us, the select board, if we wish to accept a late submittal, which I don't see a problem accepting a late submittal to that RFI.
Is that right? That's okay. Correct. There is no such thing as an RFI under the procurement law, so you're not breaking any laws.
That's what I was wondering. Yeah.
So if they wish to actually submit something to us, we can put it with the other one, and okay. We would have that number with us.
Because the other one, you know, as we all know, is primarily was Park and Rec, and we don't want that to go to the wayside either, because that is something that the Park and Rec will probably need in the future. So it might all work out for everyone.
Yeah, someone used to say I used to work.
This is about nine pieces of property you guys are buying tonight?
Could very well be.
Yeah.
Well, we have to keep our options open on what can be done. So,
well, we do need to have the numbers in front of people and tell people,
sure,
if we do this, this is what it's costing you. If we do this, this is what's going to cost
sure.
you. And that's what we heard the most out of that group meeting. And I think we're moving quite well with
where
that.
Where are we with our survey?
We need to talk more about that.
Okay.
Guilford, I think one thing is important, because I can imagine there'll be some phone calls tomorrow morning or the day after of people listening tonight, but certainly the library design, and I think the numbers that have been put together for the possible new senior center, I think it's important to stress to people who are viewing at home that these are not opulent you know, pie-in-the-sky buildings. Sometimes I hear that language around town that
Taj Mahal.
The Taj Mahal is being built. These are highly functional buildings that are taking advantage of new technology. They're clearly greener. There are savings in terms of the maintenance, the ongoing upkeep, the operations of the building in general. And also, you know, again, they're highly functional, and they're going to be able to expand the programming to underserved populations in town. The people who, and really from all walks of Hadley, who frequent the library or who would like to frequent the library, certainly the senior center, and it's taking into account the changing demographics of Hadley over the next couple of decades. So these buildings are being built, keeping in mind the Hadley values of being frugal yet appropriate to service the town going forward. So I just don't want people to think that what we're going to be talking about, as Jerry put it so nicely, are, you know, a couple of Taj Mahals planted in the middle of town.
All right. So do we have any other questions from the board? Otherwise, I'll open it up to the audience. All right, is there anyone in the audience who would like to talk about these, what we've talked about tonight?
Operational expenses of running the library, are there going to be more hours? What are we going to look at for personnel and timing and expenses once the building's up, running, and 3 months into it? What can we expect? Are the expenses going to be the same? Are we going to be looking at incremental expenses increases? What is it?
So one of the reasons we designed a one-floor library has to do with line of sight and staffing. When you have many floors to a library, you have to have staff on those floors. And the design is open so that we don't have to increase our staffing even though we're increasing our size.
Excellent.
That was really important to us and expressed to the architects. And obviously, if the building is green, we expect to have some, you know, energy savings. But the biggest thing for us was lines of sight and staffing. When we thought about building a two-story building, immediately increased your staffing.
And as Molly, I think, pointed out too, the plan is for many years ahead, and the way that a lot of these rooms and areas are set up, it's flexible. Even the circulation desk in the center of it could be moved, so if you had a big function in the middle, you can move the furnishings. Or later, if we need to have more computer stations or less computer stations, depending on the trends, the way the building is designed gives you that flexibility for the years to come. And, you know, space that you could expand if you had to, but we did go with a moderate size library compared to some of the numbers we could have gone with, just knowing that we like to be a little frugal and use our money wisely. But I think the way the design is set up and giving us that flexibility gives a lot of options.
Yeah, just a general comment about the land and looking for it. Through our discussions with the Municipal Building Committee, we've oftentimes run into this roadblock where, yeah, we'd like to do this building, but we don't have a place to put it. So we're at this junction now where we need to start thinking about that, because we just don't have the land available to do what we're talking about. So, you know, now's the time, and it's a good opportunity, and that's why we're doing it.
Mr. Neihardt?
One of the things, emphasizing more on what Molly is saying, we need to look, all these buildings that we're occupying now are 100 years plus years old. They've done well for us. The issue is we have very modern, very, very successful programs here, and we need to emphasize that. And we've taken these programs that are very successful and stuffed them into buildings that do not function well for any of them. I think we're on the opportunity with looking at all these buildings to go forward with buildings that will work with the functions of the departments, and they can be more successful, grow, and really create something that's great for our community. And that's what we've all been striving for, and I think we'll be there. But let's not think about, just because we have these buildings, we have to use them. Let's flip it around. We have great departments. Let's make sure we have buildings that fit and make these departments more successful.
Is there anybody else in the audience who would like to say something? Richard?
Nothing's been mentioned tonight about where HPAT's going to go. We're located in the senior center right now. We need space too, so don't forget about us.
I think you were mentioned when we were talking about the planning board and other groups like that. You're kind of in that little group because we also have to figure out where the house planning board and so forth. So you're being thought of. All right, so there's no more, if everybody's in agreement, we're gonna charge ahead. So the homework for those who get the RFP to review, look it over, get things back. We wanna have it back by, so we can vote on the 24th. If it actually, well, yeah, the 24th, that's what we wanna do. So that's it, I guess, if there's no more comments. Thank you for coming and I hope we can get this going.
When's your next meeting?
When's our next meeting? Next week. We're going to have weekly meetings until we can get all.
Yeah, they're every Tuesday now.
Are we going to get the RFP?
Sure.
Yeah.
Yeah, we're
going to
email it.
You said we're going to get it.
All right. Thank you very much for coming.
Thank you.
It's great to have the whole room filled every once in a while.
Introduce Mara. Popular subject. Oh, wait. It has a
and, okay, so, well actually I think this is going to pan out. If we're not careful, we're actually going to do it. Okay, so, any announcements for tonight?
Yeah.
Go for it. Go right for it.
Yeah, a couple announcements tonight. First of all, thoughts and prayers to Dr. Grodnick. He had his shoulder done today for rotator cuff, so he'll be back pitching soon. Hope you're feeling better, Doc. On Sunday, February 28th, there's going to be a Hadley Cornhole Championship. It's going to be located at Hadley Elementary School. Entry fee is going to be $20 per team. Register by February 21st at Hadley Cornhole Championship. Any questions, please contact Tom Wishkevitz at 548-0376. Tom's in charge of this, and he's doing a great job with it. Thanks.
What is it exactly?
You take and you throw the beanbag and you toss it into the leaned-up piece of board, and it goes through the hole. I hear where you're coming from. Enough said.
You know, you can go to
There are some serious cornhole chuckers here.
There is 30 teams already signed up, and they're only going to allow 64.
So this is like horseshoes, only it's cornhole.
Yeah, kind of.
Yeah,
sort of. Bags or something.
But if the bag slides off, then you just, you know.
I see.
Yeah. They're...
You can go to the hangar and try it out if you want to. They have a little court set up in the restaurant.
I see. Mm-hmm.
My money's on Peter Benben, just saying.
Okay. I guess there's college kids involved with this, and they're very into it. They, I guess over to the new hangar that they actually have an indoor arena set up for.
It's very nice. Two of them.
Yeah, over there. And for everybody wondering, the Hadley will be honoring the late Police Chief Huckowitz on a ceremony on February 20th. There's going to be a dedication held at the fire department, police and fire department down there, where a brand new bronze plaque will be placed on the wall in his honor. It's going to be between 10 a.m. and 1 o'clock, and everybody's requested to attend and honor late Chief Huckowitz for all he did for the town. And also, I know I get a couple phone calls from people who, the plaque is being sponsored by the police department and the fire department, and if anybody would like to make a contribution to them, please contact Chief Spanknebel or Chief Mason. They'd love to have some support as well from the community.
Great. Anything else?
I wish I had the article in front of me, but I'd like to say congratulations to our golf team. They placed in the first team and also
Mr. Butterfield,
Mr.
Farnham,
Spencer Butterfield, and Caleb Farnham, and then Butterfield,
Justin
Butterfield,
and Liam Higgins, maybe?
Yes.
Yeah. And then another fellow.
There was another one. Uh-oh. Sorry for that if I had put the article in front of me, but congratulations to them for doing well in golf this year.
I think we need a municipal golf course here.
Yeah. Well, we almost had one on the Hendrix farm, but that got shut down with the
we can always bid on the ledges.
Cows were going to eat the golf balls.
I don't think Cherry Hill or the ledges are too happy with theirs.
That was just a joke. Sorry about that.
How about South Hadley's?
Yeah. Any other announcements?
No.
Okay. And we have no other business, I understand, right?
So Joyce is going to be chair next week.
Yes. Yes.
And your absence.
Over agenda.
Yeah, we could probably talk a little bit about after the meeting.
You got about 10 minutes before I drop tonight.
All right. So is there a motion? So I can
motion to adjourn.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Good night, everybody.